the issues affecting you. Revealed, explained, discussed. Now on WGAL 8 In Focus.
Hello, I'm Susan Shapiro. Some call it financial anxiety. These are turbulent economic times. Inflation is at its highest level since 1981. It's costing you more to feed your family and fill your gas tank. And many have questions about what to do to plan for the future. Tonight, we're asking a financial expert about that. We're putting financial planning in focus. Joining us now is Chris Stock, who's a partner and senior wealth advisor with Domani Wealth in Lancaster. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
A senior wealth advisor. We hear a lot of terms like that, all kinds of titles that people have out there. Tell us what you do and what others in the profession do.
So I have to admit, there's a lot of different titles in our industry, and it can be very confusing for most people. Probably the most important term today would be the term fiduciary. And it's gaining much more popularity. What it really means is that we're required by law to put our clients' interests ahead of our own. And it may seem like, isn't that what everybody does?
Yeah, that seems like an obvious.
Yeah. It's unfortunately, as we sit here today, that's not true. Not everybody in our industry operates under the fiduciary standard. There are two different sides of our business. The independent advisors like us are typically fiduciaries. And then there's a broker-dealer side. A lot of the big firms that are not required to follow that standard. They have a different standard they follow. As far as our firm goes, yes, we are independent. We do operate as a fiduciary for all of our clients. We think that's important. And we know from experience that that's what clients are looking for in today's environment.
And obviously some people are selling different products, others are not. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, that's a good point. I think it's important for people to ask a lot of questions when they start working with an advisor or are already working with an advisor to know exactly what they do. Not everybody does everything. Not everybody sells insurance. Not everybody can invest in the stock market in individual stocks and mutual funds. There's annuities out there. There's life insurance and all kinds of different products. And I think it's important to find out exactly what your advisor can do and cannot do and really take a look at, from a tax planning perspective, estate planning perspective, insurance planning, like what makes the most sense for you as the end client.
Obviously, you're an advisor and you think it's important, but why do you think people should seek out advice, even people who may not have, you know, what we call a lot of wealth?
I think what we find is that people don't know what they don't know, and I think everybody's hesitant to pay a fee or pay a commission to an advisor. They think, well, I can save money and do it myself and do a better job. What we find is that's typically not the case. Countless times we see people come in and we're kind of surprised in what we see. And I think there's a lot of advice that we provide that not everybody would know otherwise. I mean, if you don't do it every day, you're not going to know the ins and outs of all the different things in the stock market, the economy and everything, or what products are out there, what their costs are. I mean, there's a lot of different things that we do that are, quote unquote, behind the scenes that people wouldn't know that we do.
Right, that's why you call professionals to do different things. You say sometimes it surprises you. What surprises you when you see somebody who may not have had an advisor?
A lot of times they'll have accounts in a lot of different places. They'll have no idea how they work together. They don't know what their stock or bond allocation is because every account's different. They don't know whether they're on track for retirement because nobody's ever run the numbers for them. Are they saving enough? Are they saving more than they need to? They can retire early. All kinds of questions that we have that people don't know to ask.
Yeah.
And that's why they need professional advice.
Well, it's a confusing landscape out there. All right. Right now, a lot of people are having financial anxiety or angst.
Absolutely.
How do you deal with that?
Yeah, I mean, it's normal. I think we should all feel some anxiety in this current environment that we're in, economically, politically. I mean, it's certainly challenging. Obviously, inflation is very high. Interest rates are rising quickly. And we have the Russia-Ukraine war. It's the three prong that's been hurting everything this whole year. And until we get some of those under control, a little more clarity, we're going to continue to see volatility in our investments. And yeah, so anxiety is normal. If you're not feeling anxiety, maybe you should. And I know people, we hear that, oh, I'm not looking at my accounts. it's okay to look at them, but I think what's important too is you need to have an advisor that you trust and have a relationship with that you can have a conversation. I don't think it's healthy to just ignore it. I think you should have a conversation, talk about what's going on, talk about the long-term impact, the short-term impact, and that'll help you feel better, be able to sleep at night. I mean, it's important for our health, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So I guess what you do is also a little bit of psychology. You become people's sort of therapist in a way.
Absolutely. I mean, we kind of joke about that a lot of what we do is behavioral management. And in a period like this, it's people that are nervous about the markets and should I be selling stocks? And typically we're telling them to do the opposite. And a couple years ago when the market was booming, they wanted to buy more stocks. They wanted to get more aggressive. And it's kind of that behavioral management at all times, trying to keep people on track for where they need to be, not where they feel like they should be.
Yeah, right.
We find that risk tolerances change as the economy changes. If things are going well, everybody wants to be high growth stocks. And then when things aren't going well, they want to go all to cash. And neither of them are the right answer. You got to be diversified across the board at all times,
in our
opinion.
Stay with us, Chris. We'll talk more about the stock market and why you should care even if you don't think of yourself as an investor.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
We continue our conversation with Chris Stock, who's a partner and senior wealth advisor with Domani Wealth. Why should people who may not consider themselves investors care about the stock market?
We believe that the stock market is a great place to invest your money. We know from experience that the stock market is probably the best place to hedge inflation in the long run. So I think no matter what age you are, whether it's in a 401k plan or an IRA, I think you should have stock market exposure. The younger you are, the more stock market exposure you should have. That's what we believe, and I think is the right answer in the long run.
Right. But there is an inherent risk.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's important to have an advisor that has asked the questions to you about what your risk level is, because not everybody should be heavily into the stock market. For example, if you're recently retired, you shouldn't be high in the stock market. You should be much more conservative now because you want to draw an income stream from it. And then you got to be able to weather the ups and downs of the market like we're in right now. You don't want to be selling stocks right now while the markets are down to generate income to live on.
Right.
We think you should have some cash available for those needs.
You want to sell high, buy low, right?
That's exactly right.
All right, stock market 101. We throw up those numbers every day on our newscast. The Dow, the NASDAQ, the S&P. Can you just give us a rundown of what that means?
Yeah, I mean, the S&P 500 is an index of the largest 500 companies in the U.S., so it's a good broad indication of how well earnings are, how well the economy is doing. When the index goes up, that means companies' earnings are growing and their stock price is going up. The Dow, while it's only 30 companies, is a broad mix of companies. It's much more used just because historically that was kind of the index. Even though stocks come in and out of that index, still is a pretty good proxy for what the markets are. So I think it's important to understand that, and that what the stock market is, it's to have an ownership in a company and be part of their future growth and future earnings growth.
And the S&P and the NASDAQ, then obviously tech stocks are more in the NASDAQ from what
yes,
I gather.
NASDAQ is more tech, more small and mid-sized tech companies. Yep, you see a lot more volatility with the NASDAQ than you would with the S&P 500 because the NASDAQ's more growth companies and they're smaller companies.
There's I know, some days you'll see the Dow, you know, way down, but the NASDAQ might be up.
True, and that has to do with the companies that are there and based on what's happening in the news. Maybe a growth company came out with a negative earnings report. Maybe the whole sector is down because of that, but that might not affect some other more mature, we call them value companies that pay a good dividend. Maybe they're going to be able to sustain that short term a little better.
All right, you mentioned the term, and we're certainly hearing a lot these days, inflation. What is that? And again, why should people be concerned about inflation?
Inflation is certainly the hottest word in our industry right now, in every industry, really. Inflation is normal, but we want low inflation. The Federal Reserve has set a target of 2% inflation. And for the last decade or so, we've had low inflation. We've kind of forgot what inflation was because it's been 40 years since we've had anything remotely close to this. So, yeah, high inflation right now is certainly a big buzzword. Well, we're seeing it at the gas pump, the grocery stores. You see it in real estate prices for sure. The Federal Reserve needs to get it under control to get this economy under control, and that's their number one goal right now. And what they're doing is raising interest rates to try to slow down the economy. We saw three Fed raises already this year. We're expecting
the interest rates you're talking about, right?
The Fed overnight rate is the Fed funds rate. They've had three raises. The next one is supposed in a couple weeks. They're talking either 75 basis points or a full percentage point. Again, to continue to slow down the economy, to stave off inflation.
Yeah, all right. Well, let's talk more when we come back about the stages of life that people may be in, from a young person to someone who's ready to retire, and how that factors in to what you should do. Stay with us.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
We're getting some free advice about money and spending from Chris Stock, who's a partner and senior wealth advisor with Domani Wealth. We talked about people being at different stages of life. Obviously, that factors into how you should invest, how you should spend. What about someone, you know, just starting out who may not know anything and have really very little money to invest? What should they consider?
I think it's important to start somewhere. Most companies offer a retirement plan, whether it's a 401k, a simple IRA. You got to get started. In most cases, they offer an employer match. It may not seem like an important thing, but the time value of money is so important. Even if you just start at 3% of your pay and get matched 3%, it has a dramatic impact over a 20, 30, 40-year time frame. So we tell all the young people to get invested now, because if you wait till you're in your 40s, you kind of lose that time value of money.
Yeah, it may not seem like a lot, even, you know, a small amount, as you said, that can build up over time.
Yes, that's exactly right. It's about getting invested and staying invested. And in times like this, it's not about being nervous about the short term. In fact, you view it as a buying opportunity. For those that are still working, you're buying on sale every paycheck right now. And if you haven't accumulated a lot of money, you haven't lost a lot of money to this point. So buying as much as you can right now, you're going to look back 3, 5, 7 years from now and say, I'm glad I did that, because now I have a lot more money than I would have otherwise.
Right. And the price of whatever you bought is now higher, right?
Correct.
Or hopefully. Yep. All right. And what about, you know, families, obviously, who have young children who are maybe buying a house or have bought a house? Obviously, they have a lot of expenditures. So what should they be thinking about?
Well, I think it's important to understand what this inflation is doing to people, and what this pending recession is doing to people. And everybody's hearing the word recession. It's important to understand what your budget looks like. And it's natural to pull back on discretionary spending, such as maybe you don't have as much entertainment, like the movies, sporting events, that type of thing. Maybe you don't travel as much. That's normal. We see that in all recessionary periods. People kind of pull back their spending. And then in growth periods, we see people spending a lot more. It's a normal occurrence for sure.
Obviously, those folks are also saving for college, you know, or as I said, for a house. So they may be a little nervous about all of that.
Well, if you're saving for college, again, it's more about the timing of it. If your child's going to college in the next couple of years, hopefully you don't have too much in the stock market at this point, that you've dialed back that risk. If they're really young, staying aggressive is the right answer, and buying more right now while the market's down makes a lot of sense. Real estate-wise, I mean, we're certainly in an overheated environment in real estate. It appears that this higher interest rate environment is starting to cool real estate, which is a positive thing, because it's not normal to be able to people were buying houses sight unseen in less than 24 hours.
Right, with no inspections, right?
Yeah, that's not normal. So now we're seeing a little more time that way. I mean, mortgage rates have gone from the threes to near 6%, and that's a good thing to cool down that real estate market. We don't feel like it's going to be a bubble of any sort like we had in the recession of 08, 09. There's just too much demand from buyers.
And not enough housing out there.
Not enough housing, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So while cooling it down is a good thing, we don't see it plummeting much because there's plenty of buyers out there waiting for the economy, the real estate prices to cool, and then they'll be buying in. So we still think it's a good place to be. We think you should be diversified, have money in the stock market and money in real estate. I think that's a good way to go.
All right. And what do people, those of us at the total other end, maybe nearing retirement or even in retirement, what should they consider?
Well, higher interest rates are being viewed as a negative thing, but for retirees, it's actually a very good positive. We're seeing that savings accounts, money market, CDs are starting to pay interest rates again. That means bonds are going to start paying higher interest rates again. For somebody who's in retirement, if we can lock in a good bond yield, knowing that if we hold that bond to maturity, we get our money back, that's a pretty safe income for a retiree. And that takes a lot of the pressure off of the rest of the portfolio when it comes to how much you have in the stock market.
And what would be the term of those kinds of bonds? Can they be anything? I mean, 10 years, 5 years?
You can be all maturities. I mean, currently, we're pretty short on maturities and our duration because in a rising rate environment, you don't want to have too much exposure at what we call the long end. As rates lock in, go to higher rates, we can go longer term on the maturities and the duration and lock in a good interest rate.
I was just reading about the I bonds that the government offers that seem to be pretty popular right now.
It's very popular. The downside to it is that you can only buy it through Treasury Direct, so no advisor out there can buy it for you, and you're capped at $10,000 per person per year. So while it sounds great on paper, it doesn't have a big impact when it comes to the portfolio.
All right. I heard 9%, but that sounded pretty good. All right. Well, stay with us, Chris, and we'll talk more about I know you don't have a crystal ball, but what the future may hold for all of us.
This is WGAL 8 In Focus, coverage you can count on.
We're talking about your money with Chris Stock, who's a partner and senior wealth advisor with Domani Wealth. Chris, I know none of us has a crystal ball, but what do you see for the future?
Well, obviously, we're seeing a lot of volatility right now. We're going to continue to see that as long as inflation is a concern, which is why the Fed's been so aggressive. If we can get inflation under control, I think that will really help the overall markets and the overall economy. The other factor is the Russia-Ukraine war. We're seeing a lot of impact on oil prices and wheat prices from Ukraine and Russia. So getting those under control is going to be important. And once that happens, I think you're going to see a recovery in the markets. When that happens is obviously the big unknown. We certainly are still positive about the longer term, even 1 to 3 year period. There's too many positives out there when it comes to the jobs market.
It's funny, in many ways, the economy is doing well. The unemployment
right.
rate is low, and as you said, there's lots of jobs out there.
Yeah, and we've never had a recession with a declining unemployment rate, at least not since World War II, I believe. So until we see the jobs market reverse, if we are in a recession right now, the thought is that it's probably going to be a very short one, because between real estate and jobs, we think it could potentially recover pretty quick.
How do we know we're in a recession? Do we only know that once we come out of it?
Well, historically, the definition was two consecutive quarters of negative GDP. That's growth in the economy. We did have a negative first quarter. The jury's still out on the second quarter. We'll be getting some numbers here soon. Some people think it's going to be slightly positive, some think slightly negative. It certainly feels like we're in a recession, whether we're there or not, and that's normal. We normally don't know it until after the fact, or at least a couple quarters later.
You mentioned oil prices obviously affecting gas prices, which have come down slightly, but not a lot. I'm still near $5 a gallon. Do you think we'll ever go back to the $3 mark or so?
We certainly hope so. Again, no crystal ball there. As long as Russia and Ukraine is still having their conflict. It's gonna hurt gas prices. We certainly have seen a cooling effect there. Commodities across the board have come back down a little bit. So maybe inflation is not going to be as strong in the second half of the year as it was in the first. But again, the jury is still out.
Yeah. And again, I know we talked early on about the anxiety factor. If you leave people with a message, what should you think they should do in terms of that?
I think it's important to have a trusted advisor to talk to, take a long-term approach, and actually run a retirement projection. We call it a financial plan. What does your situation look like, and what has this year done to that long-term plan? In many cases, we haven't deviated from that plan. People are still on track or are still okay in retirement. So it's understanding that there's always going to be short-term noise, and you got to stay focused on the long-term, regardless of your age. I understand that older people say, I'm not going to be here in the long-term. Well, in the 3 to 5 year time frame, for sure, you need to stay positive, because we will get out of this.
Yeah. Well, and our children and hopefully grandchildren are going to be here, so you need to be concerned. And I guess you can't look back. I've had people, now at some point I think, I wish back then I would have just taken everything and had it in cash. But, I mean, I guess you can't do the what I should have done.
It would be great if you could time the market. Nobody's historically been able to do it well. So our belief, and we know this from our experience, is to get invested, stay invested, and be diversified. That's really the right answer.
All right. That's what we hear. Thanks so much, Chris. We appreciate all of your time and your advice. Thank you for joining us for WGAL 8 In Focus. For all of us at WGAL, I'm Susan Shapiro. Join us again next Saturday night at 7 o'clock for WGAL 8 In Focus, right after NBC Nightly News. And you can watch each episode of In Focus, plus WGAL's latest newscasts, original programming, and more. Just download the Very Local app and stream for free on Roku and Amazon Fire TV.